you introduced me this concept of something can be valuable or expensive, not both. Expand on that a bit for me.
Yeah. Well, any let's take a service. You could pay one person $3,000 for a service, pick any number, let's just say 3,000. And that could be expensive if it wasn't useful, valuable, if it didn't return its investment, if there wasn't commensurate value, or ideally a multiple of what it cost, right? So person A gets paid 3,000. That was expensive because it was a waste. Person B gets paid 10,000, more than three times, but it was valuable because it returned a multiple of what it cost. So in the latter case, we wouldn't say that $10,000 was expensive. It generated some multiple, maybe 10 or 100 times that number. But I think the same can hold true for experiences, a nice vacation or a nice car. If we characterize and frame the things that we love as expensive, there's kind of a negative frame to that. If a purchase, a vacation, a car, some luxury, something you want to honor yourself with is within your means, then I call it valuable. I don't think meals or cars or anything are expensive if I can do them and if I enjoy them and they were enjoyable. And then, the same way we apply it to a business service or, a consultant or an advisor of some kind.
It, obviously, in order to create a service or a product, whatever it is that is valuable as opposed to expensive, there obviously has to be quite a bit of thoughtfulness put into it from the point of view of the seller, the offerer of the service or product. Do you think is perhaps the most important thing in that, the framing of it to the consumer so they understand the value, or do you think it's the way they put the offer together? Any insight on that?
When it comes to services, business services, consulting, advising, I think it's a balance. I mean, there's a few moving parts. On the one hand, always under promise and over deliver. But even in the context of under promising, you want to be expressive and shameless about the value that you do bring. It's hard to get hired if you really hold back on what it is you know you can deliver. So when you have confidence, when you have prowess in a particular area, I think you get loud and proud about it. And then however it is you've expressed it, just deliver more when you get on the court.
So it's up to you to articulate the ultimate value, and it's up to you to deliver more than you promised as well.
It takes confidence. No surgeon would touch a patient on an operating room table if he or she didn't feel the confidence to get through that with success. A lot of other business services and advisory services, people take on stuff that they really shouldn't take on. They operate on patients that they shouldn't. They touch businesses that they shouldn't. There are a lot of advisory activities that are not accredited or that don't have professional degrees associated with them. So anybody that's in the market for advisory services of any kind, consulting, et cetera, needs to be really rigorous about, the men and women that they're engaging.
Absolutely. About a decade ago, you spoke at one of my events in New York City back when you were still a city guy.
I recall.
And you said something that I can't articulate nearly as well as you can, so I'm going to ask you about it. That really stuck with me when you were talking about sort of selling or providing value to consumers, and when you were asking a consumer what their issue was. There were things that they knew that they were willing to say, things they knew they weren't willing to say, and things they didn't even really understand what was driving it below.
Yeah.
Can you just articulate that? Because I love how you say it.
Well, you recalled it extremely well. That's a concept that I, over the years, have called the drivers of desire, which are, as you said it, if people were asked, what would they say, what would they not say, and what they can't say. So what they'll say is what they're freely willing to, they're aware of it and they're willing to share it and say it. What they won't say is they have that same level of awareness, but they hold it back. It's too embarrassing, they're shy, it's private, taboo, those kinds of things. So that's awareness, not saying. And then what they can't say is what they have no awareness of, but which nonetheless is operating in the limbic brain, the survival-based brain, that does, as you know and as we've discussed, that really does drive resonance with marketing, resonance with personalities, resonance with websites and platforms, and ultimately a decision to take action, to engage, to provide an email address, to buy, to do those kinds of things. Human beings are animals, and animals need to feel safe. There's lots of things on a website that why people might bounce, why people might leave that website, where they couldn't even explain to you why, But in some way, shape, or form, their brain said, we're not safe here, we got to get out of here. That could be a typeface. It could be a stock photo that looks very fake. It could be a personality who has a very high level of ego or self-orientation, and really the level of purpose or contribution isn't really present. So people leave marketing messages and websites for all kinds of reasons, some of which they could describe, and probably the most important ones they can't.
And so in order to connect at the deepest level with a prospect, is it telling them the thing they don't know that they don't understand? And how do you utilize that to help more people?
Well, it's a nuanced approach. You know, even if you were to describe this model of psychology to consumers, it wouldn't necessarily resonate with every person. But what we can always count on is that the human brain will respond in a relatively predictable way. Now, that may not be true of one individual person, but when you have a group of 10,000 or 100,000 or a million people, in the aggregate, that number of people performs and behaves in a very predictable way. As an example, humans are animals, and then we call the world of nature animals, right? Animals in pain, in the fullest expression of pain in nature, an animal can't gather food, and it can't defend itself. So in nature, an animal, you know, in severe pain generally won't survive very long. For human beings, we have so many ways to address pain that we don't think of pain as a survival threat, even though in our subconscious, pain is that same survival threat that it would be to an animal in nature. That's why on TV, when you see commercials for pain relief products or aspirin or prescription medications that support arthritis pain, you'll always see people moving, you know, because movement is the key to gathering food and defending oneself as an animal. So you'll see people that are older people that are gardening or hiking or swimming or doing those kinds of things. So it, you know, those are the big agencies that support the big pharmaceutical companies that have a command on that kind of psychology. So it's presented in a nuanced way. You know, we don't say to human beings, we know that really in your brain, pain is a survival threat. We don't say that stuff. We don't address it directly. We just create messaging and, you know, craft images and messaging that satisfy that part of the viewer's brain where they feel safe and taken care of.
And if you can figure out that messaging, you can work for any message, right?
Oh, exactly. Exactly. It could be tennis rackets, butterfly nets, cars, airplane rides, anything. Yeah.